利亚内战数十年，政府没有办法掌握全局，也让恐怖组织青年党趁机做大。他们派人埋伏在通往难民营的马路上，所以想要卖食物给难民的商人得先向他们缴钱才能够抵达难民营，而就算赚了钱之后也还要再缴税给他们。后来这些青年党甚至还拦截了联合国的救援车辆。
东非的索马利亚长期被极端组织青年党占领。CNN 记者来这追查，他们是如何壮大声势。
First of all, we need to talk to the guy who is the who knows most about the financing.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Fine.
政府情报人员带着记者走到一栋废墟的建筑物内，这里关了他们抓到的青年党分子。手被上铐的男子罪行是对运送物资的卡车强行收取所谓的过路费。
This is Bourdon refugee camp. There are a steady flow of refugees coming in here every day. It's impossible to access without an escort from the African Union. And the people fleeing into here are fleeing drought and they're fleeing conflict.And of course, it's those two combinations that are so profitable for groups like Al-Shabaab and other warlords.
法蒂姆一家逃来难民营之前养了十二只羊跟七只牛，遇上干旱，什么都没了，成了27万难民中的一员。但纵使来到难民营，不管你是谁，都还是摆脱不了青年党的荼毒。
This man was a Shabaab tax collector for 8 years. Merchants bringing food for sale to refugees pay Al-Shabaab to get to Baidoa.And tax them there too.
And if they don't pay,
hope that gets better than Lebanon.
They capture and kill.
后来，联合国派车子送粮食到难民营，但一包米竟被青年党征收$3的过路费才肯放行。
So this doesn't work. You're saying it doesn't work. The UN is still indirectly paying tax to Al-Shabaab.
Absolutely. For the sake of roadblocks.
不管是一般商人还是联合国的卡车，只要没有武力自我防卫，都会被这群青年党流氓勒索。于是联合国改变做法。
To avoid theft of supplies, the UN switched to directly transferring cash to refugees last year, and that shifted responsibility for moving food to merchants.
唯一一条把物资送入拜多亚难民营的马路，换谁送食物去？倒霉的就是谁？但拜多亚死于大饥荒的人数动不动就是20-30万起跳，不送粮食进去只会让情况更糟糕。因此，青年党靠着这条路，一天赚近$5,000。
If reduced, that will affect the general operations negatively.
They will leave a vacuum that Al-Shabaab could step into.
Absolutely, it will leave a vacuum.
但无奈，非洲联盟的22,000兵力在2年内要逐渐缩编，未来青年党恐趁机做大。而在中美洲加勒比海，则是有全球知名的慈善团体乐施会被踢爆，在2010年海地大地震期间，在当地买春。
According to the Times, the report revealed 7 Oxfam employees staged orgies with prostitutes, and that minors may have been among those sexually exploited.
这名参加赈灾的乐施会带队主任，当时还透过视讯接受访问。
I have to make a choice between trying to save lives of thousands of people and putting my staff at risk.
没想到乐施会却出了一群不孝员工，不仅让团体名声蒙羞，也让劫后余生的灾民陷入另一个痛苦的深渊。TVB 新闻综合报道。
海龟在地球上已经存在1亿年之久了，但是因为人类的滥捕，这种远古物种现在已经濒临灭绝。而在中美洲，又因为有吃海龟蛋的习俗，所以黑市的价格很高。现在为了保护海龟蛋，动物保育组织利用 3D 列印制作了外形非常逼真的假海龟蛋，里面还暗藏了 GPS 追踪器，要来追踪偷海龟蛋的不法分子。
地点在中美洲的哥斯达黎加，因为洋流和气候的关系，每年都有大批海龟来到这片沙滩产卵。但现在海龟已经面临生存危机。
Among the biggest threats, humans. They encroach on their habitats and kill them for their meat and for their shells to make jewelry.
走在大街上，每一摊小贩都在贩售海龟的相关纪念品，尽管这是违法的，但抓不胜抓。
Across Central America, poachers destroy more than 90% of sea turtle nests on unguarded beaches.
海龟蛋在这里是很珍贵的东西，当地人有吃海龟蛋的习惯，小贩会用腌料把海龟蛋给腌起来，一盒一盒贩售。
These are sea turtle eggs, and there are two ways this situation can play out. There's either or there's
海龟蛋如果都被偷光光，那么海龟从此在地球上灭绝的时间恐怕不会太远。该如何保护这些海龟蛋呢？一名住在美国密西根州的生态学家想出了一个办法。
Hi, I'm Kim Williams-Gian.
为了追踪盗猎者的下落，他开始动手做手工艺，在假的海龟蛋里头藏进 GPS 追踪器。
They have to have the right feel because sea turtle eggs are kind of a little soft and squishy. They're not like chicken eggs. We've been using a 3D printer and a kind of flexible plastic, but they still don't look quite right.
于是他们找来这个专家帮忙加工。
Hello, I'm Lauren.
罗伦在好莱坞工作，他是专门为电影人物做特效的化妆师。
It was like the best way that I could use my skills making prosthetics, but to actually like help a whole species of turtles, it's a dream job.
经过了他的巧手，这个海龟追踪器几乎跟真的没有什么两样。接下来就要执行任务了。
We'll walk together as a group.
太阳下山后，大家开始在沙滩上寻找产卵的海龟。
Oh, there you go.
这只海龟一共产下了50多颗卵。工作人员一边数，一边把追踪器放进去。
She has no idea it's there. The poachers won't know it's there.
当盗猎者把海龟蛋偷走时，也会一并把追踪器拿走。这个时候就可以循着 GPS 发出的讯号，查出到底是谁偷走了蛋，以及到底卖到哪里去。
And then the mileage, so we can start to get an idea of like not only where they're going, but how fast they're moving, what type of vehicles they're using.
当地也有所谓的环保警察，不过仅有吓阻的效果，重点还是观念要改变。
The people know that it's an endangered species, that it shouldn't be done. They just don't want to change. That's why we're working with kids, because they can change. They can learn. They can take new ideas, make a generational change.
当地的保育单位开始办活动，让孩子们到沙滩上一起看小小海龟孵出，奋力往大海前进。没有消费就没有杀戮，只能期待这些孩子带来新的局面。 TVBS 新闻综合报道。
这也是一个新的局面，新的正义。从2017年10月开始，在4个月内，有超过70名女子指控好莱坞制片韦斯坦对他们毛手毛脚，甚至性侵。纽约检方正式对韦斯坦跟他成立的公司提起了诉讼，因为这一间公司违反了州立法令，管理不善，没有好好保护他们的员工。不过，最近发起 Me Too 反性侵活动的女议员却被指控，她也跟韦斯坦一样，对员工伸出咸猪手。
好莱坞金牌制作人哈维·韦斯坦性侵女星事件曝光后
，I don't feel comfortable.
I mean, don't have a fight with me.
It's not nice.
Please, I'm not going to do anything. I swear, my children, please come in.
引发一连串风暴，女性们顺势带动女性们一个个跳出来，在社群媒体上告诉大家自己曾被性骚扰或是性侵的可怕经历。
So millions of people have come out posting Me Too.I applaud them all. I think it's brave, and I think it's important to speak out and not be shamed by anyone.
最新一位勇敢揭发韦斯坦恶行的女星是靠电影《追杀比尔》走红的乌玛·舒曼。
She says she was attacked in two different occasions by Harvey Weinstein, once in Paris, once in London. She says they had a good relationship before this.
乌玛·舒曼去年11月就曾暗示自己也是受害者之一，但直到今年2月，忍了25年，她才终于说出当年韦斯坦性侵的细节。但韦斯坦这方依旧矢口否认，还说乌玛·舒曼是在跟他调情。
And after misreading her signals, after a flirtatious exchange in Paris, for which he immediately apologized and deeply regrets. However, her claims about being physically assaulted are untrue.
纽约检方日前正式对韦斯坦以及他跟弟弟鲍勃成立的韦斯坦影业提起诉讼。
New York's Attorney General is suing Harvey Weinstein and his former company for alleged misconduct. Eric Schneiderman says the Weinstein Company broke state law by not protecting its employees from pervasive sexual harassment.
但这起事件并没有完美的告一段落。Me Too 反性侵运动的幕后推手加州众议员加西亚最近被爆料自己竟然是性侵的加害者。
A drunk Garcia cornered him after a softball game in 2014, stroked his back, squeezed his buttocks, and then attempted to touch his crotch.
受害男子名叫费耶罗，是另一名议员的下属。他表示，此事没有严重到要毁了他，但对这位议员，他已有了不同的看法。
I think now I'm definitely looking or processing it differently than when it happened, but that doesn't change what happened.
而有部分人士开始反思，指出在社群媒体再次写下自己的痛苦经历，对阻止性侵真的有帮助吗
？But others worried that the campaign pressured women to reveal intensely painful episodes, possibly re-traumatized.Them. Others question whether tweets and posts have any real impact on stopping men from abusing women.
也有人质疑响应 Me Too 活动 PO 的文章并不是每一篇都百分百属实。但无论如何，好莱坞这惊天一爆。
Do you have any advice for a young girl moving to Hollywood?
I'll get libeled with
that. Harvey Weinstein invites you to a private party in Four Seasons.
一个有明星梦的女孩，一个警戒。TVBS 新闻综合报道。
说到梦，有一种梦叫清醒梦，它的意思是做梦的人意识很清楚，甚至还可以主动来控制部分的梦境。这听起来有点像是电影《全面启动》的情节。不过，像这样的清醒梦确实是存在的。根据统计，大约有20%到30%的人曾经做过清醒梦。科学家说，目前人类对于这种梦的研究还不够多，但是透过训练，可以让人拥有做清醒梦的能力。
电影《全面启动》讲的就是做梦的故事。
We create the world of the dream. We bring the subject into that dream, and they fill it with their secrets.
但其实，这种可以控制的梦，或者叫做清醒梦的概念，现实生活里真的有可能发生。
Frequent lucid dreamers claim that they can control many parts of the dream.Such as teleporting themselves to another location, learning to improve real-life skills, or even eating fire.
到底这是白日梦还是纯粹在幻想？人类目前为止对于清醒梦的真假还是很难判断。
Scientists have designed experiments, and they've been able to demonstrate objectively that when people say that they're doing something in their dream, that they actually are.
这套系统其实就是透过核磁共振造影机来观察人的脑部变化，特别是脑部活动区域的血液流动的情形。科学家们征求了6名曾经有过清醒梦经验的人，要求他们在梦里头紧握左手或右手，之后把他们送进机器里头睡觉。结果显示，控制左手的运动皮质区显现出来的亮光和他在清醒状态时的握拳相同，意思是某种程度，人真的可以控制你的梦境。
Dreams feel real while we're in them. It's only when we wake up that we realize something is actually strange.
但为何有人做过清醒梦，但大部分的人却没有过？这样的经验呢
？It seems to be only around 20% to 30% of the population are actually natural lucid dreamers. So perhaps if it was so beneficial, Mother Nature would have had all of us being capable of lucid dreaming. And the fact that we're not, perhaps means that it's not necessarily beneficial. But we actually don't know.
的确，人类所知有限，至少对于脑部还有多少神秘的区域都还很难掌握。也有专家认为，会做清醒梦的人恐怕是脑部有病变的前兆。但也有科学家认为，做清醒梦有助于增强记忆力，提升创造力。
When most of us dream, our thoughts and actions are involuntary. The dream plays out as if we were watching a movie.But not all dreams are the same. There is another kind of dreaming called lucid dreaming, which is more like playing a video game than watching a movie.
专家说，如果你也想控制自己的梦境，想做清醒梦，其实是可以训练的。譬如，你梦到你正在游泳，突然间， 股强大的力量将你往下拉，你溺水了，你挣扎，你求救，最后梦醒了，你也吓出了一身冷汗。但如果你想控制梦境，试着制作我做了什么梦的清单，写日记，记下自己做的梦，这比较有机会可以帮助你进入清醒梦的状态。 TVBS 新闻综合报道。
而为什么听到别人笑，您也会想跟着笑呢？直到现在，科学家都还在研究笑容到底是从脑内的哪个部位来驱动的，但是还没有得到一个定论。只是现在发现，人类大脑中的笑声触发装置是无意识的，在笑的时候会刺激到的大脑部位不止一个，也就是说，要不要笑不是自己能控制的。
想到好笑的事，我们自然就会发出笑声，而且每个人的笑声都不一样。但神奇的是，听到别人笑，你也会想笑。笑到底有什么样的魅力？科学家一直致力想了解笑容背后的科学，或是该如何解释笑容是怎么产生的。从1776年化学家普利斯特里发现笑气的时候，他发现吸入笑气就能让人心情愉悦，当时还被称为是来自天堂的气体。一直到达尔文也曾研究过人脸表情的不同之处，直到现在科学家都还在研究笑容是从大脑的哪个部位驱动的，但还没有得到一个定论。为此，学者开始研究我们笑的时候会有什么样的行为。
First of all, we found that males were the best laugh getters. Both women and men laugh more when men are speaking to them than when women are speaking to them.
除了性别上的不同外，学者也发现我们多半是和人们聚在一起的时候才会笑，很少是单独一人自处时在笑的。
1, 2, 3.
为了更进一步探索我们笑的原因，科学家还特别去研究了人类的近亲猩猩，发现猩猩也有类似人类笑容的表情。
A relaxed, open-mouthed expression. An expression that's reminiscent of human laughter.
这被动物学家归类为在玩乐的表情，就和我们在笑的时候一样，而在猩猩身上则是在打闹玩耍时可以看到。
Here, the small one chasing the big one. He gets a little kiss, actually, in response. And while they're playing, they laugh. Listen.
动物也会发出笑声，这让科学家确定笑是万物共通的，而在动物身上可能是要对彼此释放出友善讯息。不过可以确认的是，只要有笑声，不管是人还是动物，情绪都会转为是正面的。最好的例子可能是这个时候。
You were writing was that today's meeting with President Bill Clinton was going to be a disaster.
前俄罗斯总统叶尔钦访问美国时，突然帮克林顿说话，大骂美国媒体，让克林顿不顾形象冒出了巫婆笑声。
Well, now for the first time, I can tell you that you're a disaster.
这么一笑，让原本超严肃的记者会也轻松了起来。克林顿笑到哭的画面更成为一大经典。笑容背后的脑科学或许还复杂难解，但可以确定的是，每日一笑绝对能让我们有好心情。TVB 新闻综合报道。
美味的波士顿派起源地是波士顿的一间饭店，饭店大厨用海绵蛋糕、卡士达酱、巧克力酱跟碎杏仁创造出了这一款糕点的丰富口感，不只为饭店打响名声，更成为了麻州的代表甜点。当地许多商家还推出了创新造型的波士顿派。
提到波士顿派，你会想到什么？
Luscious golden cake and cream inside chocolate on top.
一讲到这款甜点，每个人脸上都露出幸福的表情。
It's got almost every texture you would expect from a dessert: smooth, creamy, chocolatey.
It's a multi-textural and taste sensation.
闻名世界的波士顿派起源地在这边。
Boston cream pies originate here.
This is why people come to the Parker House, and it is now the Massachusetts state dessert.
这间饭店可是有着悠久历史。
This is the main dining room. This table that we're actually sitting in is table 40. This is where JFK proposed to Jackie.
Ho Chi Minh worked at the hotel. when he was in exile from Vietnam. So he worked here as a pastry chef.
让人念念不忘的美味波士顿派制作方式其实很简单。
It's just a plain sponge cake. We don't put any flavor in it. Our flavor comes from our pastry cream. We use a vanilla pastry cream.
在海绵蛋糕之间加上厚厚的一层卡士达酱，这样还不够，蛋糕周围也要抹上一层。
You have to have more pastry cream around it so that the almonds have something to stick to.
完成蛋糕主体之后，最上层再加上半糖黑巧克力，然后拿出挤花袋，用白巧克力酱画出圆圈，在师傅巧手下做出花纹装饰。
You just go into the middle, all the way around.And then out towards yourself.
最后在蛋糕旁边加上满满的碎杏仁。
And there's the full Boston cream pie. We have tried to keep it as basic as possible so that people remember it and they have those memories and that they come back here for that purpose.
做法简单，但是用料实在的波士顿派，有不少商家是用同样的材料做出变化。
Not the actual pie, but like the donut, the cupcake, the ice cream. They kind of take off the actual dessert itself.
但不论怎么变，这些波士顿派都有着让甜点迷疯狂的好滋味。 TVBS 新闻综合报道。
而橄榄油在地中海饮食当中则有着不可或缺的重要地位。记者要带大家到位于土耳其的橄榄油大厂，从橄榄园的采收到榨油厂，看看橄榄油是怎么做的。除了繁复的古法程序，榨出来的油还要经过严格的抽样测试，通过了才能够装瓶，每一滴都十分宝贵。
金黄色的橄榄油又被称作液态黄金，来到地中海历史最悠久的库尔萨特橄榄园，这里每天可以生产出2000公斤的顶级初榨橄榄油。
The grade of olive oil, which is the best to be qualified as extra virgin, has to be less than 0.8% acidity.
这里从罗马帝国时代就种植大片的橄榄树林，虽然放眼望去整片绿油油，但这里其实种植好几种橄榄。想做出最好的油，靠的是经验老手的调油技巧。
As there are hundreds of varieties of olives available to make olive oil.It's the know-how of the producer to know, you know, if they're blending different olive varieties as well, it's their magical formula to yield the most amazing taste.
采收下来的橄榄混合集中清洗，放上大型输送袋去除多余的汁液，才能让橄榄油品质更纯。接着倒入大石磨碾磨成泥，这个方法可是从古时候就一直沿用到现在。
A few centuries ago, the crusher was an apparatus powered by a donkey.Today, though, a motor drives 600 kilogram granite wheels to grind the olives, pits and all, into a paste.
古时的制油大师靠的是经验判断橄榄泥的湿度和细致度是否已经到达榨油的标准，确保每一批橄榄油品质一样稳定。不过现在有了电脑帮忙，省下不少功夫。虽然工厂引进高科技，但最重要的榨油方式还是依循古法。
Traditional extracting techniques involve spreading the paste on mats and then stacking them to press out the oil.
榨出来的油经过两道过滤，就成了顶级初榨橄榄油。但在装瓶之前，还要经过严格的抽样测试。
He inhales the olive oil's aroma, like a glass of fine wine.It should have a certain bouquet, and it should taste intensely fruity. If the oil makes the grade with this tester, the entire batch is ready for packaging.
业者说，这里的橄榄树都有多年历史，每一滴油都是老祖宗的恩赐，也希望制油古法及感谢的心能够世世代代传下去。TVBS 新闻综合报道。